This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good morning and welcome to the Sunrise Safari, where there will be no sunrise. My name is James Hendry and it is my birthday. I'm 29 years old today. Thank you all already for your very kind happy birthdays. And we are here with Tingana, the thieving male leopard. He's certainly... Sorry, Dave, let's try maybe a different angle. He's a leopard that has made a very good living out of his children. This kill he stole from his daughter Tlalamba yesterday. And he's now lying in his dinner, basically. I think if we back up slightly. Oh, that's a very perfectly placed branch, that, isn't it? Superb. I'm not convinced about this, David. Let's maybe try around another way. There's a hyena. Oh, leopard, actually. Let's do that leopard, rather. I think that second leopard's better for us. I think it's his daughter, Tlalamba. Good morning, Tlalamba. It's my birthday. That is Tlalamba, isn't it? Yes, look at her. She's behaving like a buffoon, so it must be. Oh, she's hugging a little stick. Remember, you can talk to us using hashtag safariLIVE on Twitter, otherwise the YouTube chat stream. She's giving me a little birthday dance there. Yes, you are. Birthday dance for me, Tlalamba. I think I shall take some illegal photographs. Although the light is very poor at the moment. Oh, that's so sweet. What are you doing? Why are you behaving like a buffoon? Enemy mouse, maybe in the tree all night, but most likely up and down. You know, it doesn't look very comfortable, and the fact that he's lying on top of his food indicates that he's not nervous, but would be unimpressed if his dear daughter was to try and take it from him. Quite rightly so, you know. Oops, I didn't have it on silent. Sorry about that, everybody. Let me put my silent illegal photographer on. There's actually simply not enough light to take an illegal photograph here. Oh, sorry, there's an extremely loud radio now going in my nose. In my nose? The radio's not in my nose, is it, David? It's more in my ear. Wonderful. Yeah, Tlalamba and Tingana on site here at the kill site from yesterday. I'm just telling the radio what's going on. okay. It's perfectly light enough for your camera. This is just great. Our Tlalamba's about to be 2 next month. Background, you can hear a squirrel. It doesn't sound that concerned at the moment. I suspect the squirrel doesn't sound that concerned on account of the fact that the leopards have been here all night. Why are you behaving like such a buffoon? But thank you. We're enjoying it. We're enjoying your buffoonery. Alrighty, let us go across to the Wolf. He too is driving this morning. I think he's going to look for some lawns.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to my vehicle. Sorry about the fact that the pole is now in the way. We've just stopped to admire two beautiful kudu that were quite enjoying a branch that has been broken by an elephant and a process known as facilitation. You can see an adult female and her calf. My name is Steve. I'm joined once again by Owen on a very overcast and sort of cool morning. I hope all of you are having a wonderful day wherever you are. And don't forget, it is James Hendry's birthday today, so send through any well wishes you might have. Let's just have a look at this branch quickly, Owen. We'll see how this branch has been pushed over by an elephant. It's a red bush willow. So it's been snapped there at the base. Excuse me. And that has facilitated the ability for the kudu to feed on branches that would be out of their reach. So they do play a very important part, old elephants, for changing the structure and the makeup of the vegetation, and also making certain browse available to smaller antelope that would otherwise struggle to get it. Of course, the kudu are the tallest we find around here. They don't normally have too much of a trouble getting to those leaves, but imagine the Steenbok Impala Nyala. There's some food for them. Jump on board. Apparently there are some lions calling to the south. So we're going to head off in that direction. We're just checking the western side. It rained and rained and rained last night, and already we're seeing a little bit of a flush. We drove through a silver cluster leaf band just before, and they were all just bing, sticking out. Here we go. Once again, another bit of facilitation here as this small, what is that? Small little shrub has been uprooted. Looks like a buffalo thorn. No, it is a red bush willow. These impalas are absolutely loving the green leaves that have been provided. Pushed off of the tree. Brush packed, of course, on the road. But that change in the structure and in where the branches lay changes the shade aspect and also opens up an area that before was a little bit more shady. Here's a classic example of how impala are mixed feeders, feeding on the best and tastiest bits around. A few of the grasses will start to flush after yesterday, after last night's rain, and the leaves as well are going to be enjoying a little bit of rain we had. But it is going to make it rather difficult to find any tracks, because when the ground is a little bit damp, small animals with padded feet making little tracks on the ground make it quite hard. Have a look at the kudu at the back there, Owen, in the road. All the way at the back, there's a nice big male kudu. Isn't he gorgeous? The kudu have been waiting for these days, the leaves to start flushing out. I've got a strong feeling in the next 2 to 3 days you're going to see a little bit of a wild flower bloom, as well as the recovery of the grasslands. after rain, it's normally quite common. This little kudu's going to come and enjoy those leaves as well. It's quite common to have territorial animals moving, so we might be lucky. We're going to check the west and check the south. Jonathan, I actually have no idea how much rain, but that very soft sort of sideways falling rain kept going for quite a long time last night. I don't know what time it stopped. We don't have our own rain gauge here, so I'm not 100% sure, but it's damp. There's a blanket of moisture everywhere. That very nice soaking rain that doesn't drain or run away, doesn't cause any erosion. Excuse me, just settles all of the dust. Magnificent kudu that. Okay, very good. Well, we're going to move on from my impala and kudu, send you back over to the Energizer buddy, Shalamba.
Energizer bunny Talamba is not being so energetic. Oh, now she suddenly got up again. Here we go. She's been chuffing at her father, and I've never seen a leopard do that as much as this one does. She's realized she's live now. Now she's playing with some elephant dung. See her chuffing there? She'll respond to me doing it. She's not responding to my chaffing. I'm not a very good chaffer. Little mark. That's very brave. I suspect she's going to attempt an approach at the kill, despite the fact that I'm 99% sure that she knows she hasn't a chance. Up you go. There's nothing up that tree. I wonder if she's not coming into estrus. Elisa, you say she's auditioning for Hosanna's role. No, I don't think so. I very much get the impression that Talamba is her own actress. Hosanna never used to behave like this around Dad. He took a much more resigned view, I think, to having his kill stolen. He didn't try and convince his father with gentle chuffing that he should let her have something to eat. He just used to sit a bit morose below him. And then he used to groan sometimes. He used to growl in a sort of plaintive manner. He'd go, Yes, I think there's definitely an element of that, that she's trying to, that she's trying to show that she's no threat at all, that she's got no beef with him, as it were. It's definitely what that chuffing does. And interestingly, one of the adults I've seen do it is Hukumuri, and he did it with Tandi when they met on quarantine clearings once. And she ran away from him and went up a tree, and he kind of sat at the bottom and looked up at her and chuffed like this. So it's very much a sound, we think, that is supposed to de-escalate any aggression that there might be. But she's done it with him from, you know, the time she met him as a baby. It's such a cute thing to see. David, shall we move so we don't have that boosh in the way? How's that? That little black thing in front. It was a fly on my screen. I thought there was a drongo in front of her, but it was a fly on my screen. And all the while, Tingana is in a tree. Sleeping on his kill. We can hardly see him. I can see one spot. Rado, it is extremely difficult to tell if an animal is happy. In fact, it is extremely difficult to tell if an animal even experiences the feeling or emotion happiness. We think that they do because, well, anybody who's ever owned a dog or a cat, a dog specifically, can tell if that animal is happy or sad, or the canine equivalent of those two emotions. Hormonally, yes, one would assume that doing what she's doing is in some way releasing dopamine, which will make her feel a sense of satisfaction to a certain extent. It will drive her to stay here because she will be anticipating the reward of a meal. So yes, I think that there is an element of what you might certainly describe as happiness in a situation like this. It's difficult to tell, as I always say, with animals, because they don't have the facial expressions that we do, so you can tell immediately if a human being is unhappy or sad just from the way they look. But sometimes that's difficult with cats and dogs and horses, elephants. And as I always say, the closer you get to us along the primate line, the easier it becomes. All right, David, let us quickly move before she's not going up the tree. So chimpanzees have got much more facial musculature than we do, not than we do, but than most other animals do. And so you do definitely get a sense of their mood from their faces. Now Tingana is watching his daughter. She's just gone round the corner there. I think we'll just wait here and see if she doesn't pop up on the bank next to him. That is a massive impala. And I'm most impressed that the old boy managed to put it up there. Not convinced Talumba's that impressed. Doesn't seem. Doesn't seem like she's coming back this way. All right, let's go back to the Vorf. He's had two drives in a row of driving now. I'm hoping for some big luck for him.
Thanks, James. Well, thankfully it's not raining. Thankfully it's not raining. Every time I hit the brakes, the water on the roof falls down onto my leg. But isn't it the funniest when you see a leopard behaving like Talumba at the moment? all uppity. Whether she's, I don't think she's happy. She's probably quite frustrated with Dad. He hasn't given any of her food that she caught herself. Very rude, isn't it? Well, they're going to have to sort that out themselves. It's not going to be it's not the first time, and it won't be the last time that he steals from her. Oh, James, most certainly. I actually wanted to mention it last night, that after the rain that we've had, and apparently according to Marcel in the tech room, just over 3 mils of rain. It's not a lot. It doesn't seem like a lot, but it's a very soft rain. And after the rain, we do get millipedes start coming out, as well as giant land snails. So I'll definitely keep my eyes peeled. They're not the hardest things to miss, especially if they're in the road. So apparently there are lions on Little Gowrie, so the calling is coming from that direction. And apparently there are tracks of wild dogs heading west along Gowrie Main, away from Chitwa. So that is the only update that they were given. Stations from the east are busy tracking or having a look or called in the tracks. But as you know, if those dogs come north, they will be with us. So we're going to check this boundary and then check our southern boundary and see, maybe we can be lucky. Nothing really causes the dogs to go in any sort of direction. It all seems to be pretty random when they start moving. Who might they be? So a very nice birthday present for James, seeing 2 leopards on his morning. Of course, his favorite leopard is Tingana. Lauren got to see the 2 of them last night. A delayed birthday present for her. She wanted to see Tingana for her birthday, so she got him. And now, here we go. James is having a wonderful start to his day. Caroline, I'm trying to think if we do get honey guides here. There's nothing stopping us from getting honey guides. I can't recall hearing one here. A very characteristic call. I'll play it for you. Lou's saying did you say we have seen them before, Lou? We haven't. I know that the scaly-throated. Okay, so Steph has been led to beehive before by honey guide, which is great. That's probably the greater honey guide. I don't think you'll get the scaly throated. Am I getting that wrong? I think it's a scaly throated. Let me just get my app open and I'll show you the honey guide. The greater honey guide is most likely the one that we're going to find here. A lesser honey guide, you do find them around. Let me just get them for you. Let's just switch off here for a second. Have a little listen. Honey. This one is a very cool bird. It's called the Victor bird. And they do their territorial calling. They go. That is a territorial call that they'll do. And when they want to attract you to a hive, they do this very high-pitched chattering. So when you were talking to James before about, do animals get excited and happy? Well, a honey guide has evolved with humans. And with honey badgers, of course, and they know how to guide us to honey. And these guys get very happy and excited when they see us. And it's almost impossible not to follow them. They'll fly in front of you, making this high-pitched, sort of chattering, excited sound. And then you follow. And as you follow, they'll fly to the next tree. And eventually, you'll be able to get to the honey. But let me just show you the other ones. A bird, well, not the similar birds, bird family. I'll leave it like that, actually. So here is indeed the scaly-throated honey guide I've seen up in the Fever Tree Forest in Makuleki. It's got a very interesting call. I've never seen the green-backed. It's quite a forest-loving bird, or the brown-backed. So those are 2 honey guides I haven't seen yet. And the pallets, there's actually 3 that I haven't seen. And these are all brood parasites, which means they will choose whole nesting birds and lay their eggs in the nests. And these guys actually are quite commonly used around here. So maybe we'll find you one. I've heard and seen many honey guides in my life, but I can't recall hearing one here. Should I play the Victor sound for you? See how good I was. Cool, eh? Okay, well, we're going to carry on. We're going to check the southern boundary, see if we can find some tracks. And while we do that, James is still with Tlalamba, and maybe something's going to happen that side.
Well, the squirrel, unfortunately, I said was alarming for no good reason. I was wrong. She has murdered the squirrel and is now devouring it. Poor little squirrel. Not going to remember my birthday with great fondness. In fact, probably not going to remember anything else ever again. Ooh, that's a bit gruesome. If you are a sensitive viewer, I'm sorry about that. Nature can be a little gory at times. That stick is in a deeply irksome position. Things going down. I remember watching Hosanna eat a squirrel once. It took him about 10 minutes. And he basically, he plucked most of it, didn't he? I think he skinned it before swallowing it. Or maybe he gave up. I think he gave up on plucking it. David, should we just sneak another 3 inches forward to get that stick out of her face? You make a very good point, but I don't think it was the same squirrel that was alarm calling. There was still an alarm calling squirrel when this one emerged from the bushes between the teeth of Tlalamba. So I think that you'll find that the squirrel currently being devoured was ignoring its friend, which it shouldn't have been. It was a rebel squirrel, said to its overcautious friend, "What are you talking about? I can't see any danger here. You're such a ninny." Just prior to having those two sharp canines driven through the back of its head. It would have been a quick death, at least. Pretty inglorious, really, but quick nevertheless. You hear a pearl-spotted owl calling. Alex, I think they catch small prey like this all the time. I think scrub hares and squirrels and maybe even Franklins take a horrible pasting. I mean, this will barely touch sides on the poor girl, but it's something. I think there's a huge amount that we don't see these things kill. Monitor lizards and even termites they'll eat. Do you think, David, this is like having a small croissant for breakfast? Mm.
Sure.
As opposed to the full omelette that you're going to have after your croissant. I must have noticed this before, but her whiskers are looking particularly spruced and impressive today, aren't they, David? Maybe it's for my birthday that she's had them done. Butterfly, you want to know if the squirrel saw this coming? I mean, the only other way to rephrase your question, Butterfly, is was the squirrel suicidal? Or was the squirrel delusional? In other words, did the squirrel want to die? Or was the squirrel so convinced of its own strength that it thought it would be able to fight the leopard off? I'm going to go with no, it didn't know, or didn't see this coming. Squirrel would have disappeared into a thick bush had it had any idea that the leopard was coming. It probably did see the leopard just prior to it dying, and it probably uttered an expletive beginning. Well, I'm not going to tell you what it begins with, but it probably only had four letters just before. You know, it was probably eating a little nut, and then it turned round and thought, oh, beep. Before the light went out and darkness became its only world. Lovely little gentle dawn chorus this morning because there's no sun. We're told the sun will come out today as opposed to tomorrow. You may now sing the Annie song, David, if you wish to.
I'm all right.
You're okay, you don't want to sing it?
No.
You sure?
Yep.
The viewers would love to hear you sing the Annie song. Or certainly growl a version of it out. Yes, Dove, they can digest small bones. Bones are not that difficult for them to digest. They've got very acidic digestion. Same as we can digest bones if we can chew them into small enough pieces to get them down our esophaguses. I'm not sure what the plural of esophagus is. But so it's the teeth and the hair that they will not be able to digest. So, I'm pretty sure she swallowed some of its little squirrel teeth, which will come out in what some people call the scat, which is somehow considered a more polite word than poo-poo. I'm not sure why. David, all the viewers are asking if you will sing the Annie song. Do you know?
Not really.
Not really. But a little bit.
A little bit.
I'm going to sing what you know.
Only if you join me.
Okay, let's go.
Yeah.
The sun will come out tomorrow. Come on.
So that's the only part I know.
Let's do it again then, if that's the only part you know. And the sun will come out tomorrow. David, that's beautiful. It was like listening to Jose Carreras in his prime. In case you missed that, let me give you another performance of David's effort there. Bit like being serenaded by a chainsaw. David, I believe that you can sing and that you have chosen to sing in that gruff voice so that no one ever asks you to do it again.
Disagree.
Tangana is moving slightly. I mean, look, it's not a great shot, I'm just saying it's moving. That might be the case. Thank you, David. Carolyn? Carolyn, what was I going to say now? Oh, Tangana's not far. He's only about 50 meters away. David, why would you do that to me on my birthday? You're very funny today, do you? Oh, here comes a meese. Meese running in at high speed, straight past Talamba. Beastly meese, where are you going? This meese also looks like it's high energy. It's not walking up with any caution whatsoever. It's blasting in there in order to show its dominance. I'm sure that's why they come in. They're kind of adding to the shock factor. I don't know if that's Taka from yesterday. More identify a hyena on sight than I can a human being. Oh, here we go. No squirrel for you, beastly meese. Could you quickly try to swallow the rest of it? And it's gone. Right, it's like when you catch your dog eating something it shouldn't be eating. Hello, it's my birthday today. That meese has eaten something. It's got a very fat belly. Excitement, everybody. It's brightening up a little bit now. Hello, my dear. It was very elegantly done, especially on a wet branch. Dim crackle of rifle fire in the background. That is very excited people taking pictures of this glorious cat. There's a bit of squirrel left that Tsaka the hyena managed to miss. Alrighty, the wolf has managed to find himself a very interesting little bird. Let's go to him.
I have indeed. It just flowed off slightly. Here it is, Owen. Is my pole in the way? There we go, little bee eater. Beautiful to see. He was right on the ground a moment ago. Actually landed on the smallest stick on the ground. These birds necessarily can't actually land on the ground. They always have to have a little bit of elevation because they can't jump. They need to have a stick or something because when they want to take off, they just start flapping their wings and off they go. But off the ground, sometimes it's quite tricky to do so. So you'll never see a bird like this necessarily being on the ground, although they can be very close to the ground. They do nest in burrows or in banks. So to exit that, they basically fall slightly to then fly up again. And we were talking about the greater honey guide. And the honey guide is known for parasitizing on many of the starlings, barbets, woodpeckers, as well as bee eaters. Obviously, every honey guide or every brood parasite area specific has got a host that they prefer. Generally, you get a brood parasite. You wonder when you talk about great honey guide and you talk about birds like the red-chested cuckoo or the Deirdre's cuckoo, should I say, more likely the Deirdre's. They've got many, many hosts. And normally what will happen is that the individual that individual parasitizes on will be the direct lineage that all of the cuckoos or, honey guides, will then parasitize on. So if it's a wide range of species, you quite often find that the individual itself passes on the trait of a specific species, and that is how they get a variety. So, for example, Deirdre's cuckoo quite often enjoys many of the weaver species. So if you find a masked weaver, whatever chick is hatched will generally go back to the same host that it was itself hatched from and lay its egg. Often you find some brood parasites that are very specific, very species specific, and don't have a variation. But how cool is Tlalamba's little squirrel? She's like, yeah, Dad, I'll eat my own squirrel. Lorax, is there any insects bee eaters won't eat? Well, they generally eat insects of the winged kind, so insects that are flying. They don't have the ability to ferret around on the ground or to move through the tree, really, hopping through the trees. So it's always these little hawking escapades where they move off of the branch and catch something that's flying. So any of the small little insects that have wings, we saw the other day it was eating a dragonfly, which is, I thought it was maybe too big to swallow. But as the name implies, bee eaters are well known for catching bees. But they'll catch many, many things that they can. I don't know what they won't catch. Obviously, aposematic or poisonous colored insects, they'd probably leave them alone. Birds see color and they generally leave bright colored insects alone. Okay, so we haven't had any tracks of wild dogs entering. Checking the southern boundary. I'm just gonna check Twin Dams now. Lots of hyena tracks. Wonder if Hosanna will return today just to say happy birthday to James. Wouldn't that be very nice? I think we'd all like that, wouldn't we? The little chief making a return. So some of you wondering when my birthday is, it's coming up on the 28th. I don't know, is that Sunday? Is that Monday? 5 days time. Well, it's pretty quiet down here on the south. We're going to keep searching. We go through the drainage line, go have a look at Ledwood Road. In the meantime, let's send you back over to the birthday boy who's having the best time.
Yes, we're having a lovely time with our leopards here. She just gave the hyena a bit of a rev. One of those. That's quite good, wasn't it, David? She's looking at now. amazing how much patience these animals do display. I think you and I would long since have decided that we weren't going to get any kind of a kill or any kind of a meal out of Tingana. Yes, Neil, absolutely leopards catch and eat fish, especially catfish, and especially if they are stuck in mud. So you'll often find them in drying rivers or drying dam areas, catching fish and pulling them out of muddy holes. They're not fussy at all about what they eat. They have what we call a very catholic diet, and one of the big differences between them and cheetah is that they are not specialists when it comes to feeding or catching strategy. They'll employ various strategies to catch their prey. Fussy squirrels to fish to insects to great big impala and that sort of thing. I'm not sure I should move just yet. Let's try and figure out what's going on here. The otter, I think it is largely just food to them, but yes, they do. I mean, they do have taste buds. They just have far fewer than we do, which means their ability to discern flavor is that much poorer, and that's because I suppose their ability to eat things, a wider range of things that could be toxic, is much higher. So I think our refined tastes have got a lot to do with our omnivorous diet and the fact that we eat, we're not afraid to, or we have a limited tolerance to things that are potentially toxic. So we need to be able to discern what's good and what's bad more carefully than something like a leopard does. And I think that's why we've evolved the ability to taste like we have. She's now sleeping up there. That is a little irksome. We can't get up there. Let's try Dad again. He's moved a little bit. She'll be around here. I don't think she'll move far. But we can't drive up there. So let's keep going towards where Tingana is. Going to be an amazing shot, but it's a start, I suppose. Yes, Susan, absolutely, lions do kill leopards. I haven't seen it myself here, or have I? No, I haven't, but it does happen frequently. Well, not that frequently, but it can happen. We haven't caught it on camera. We have caught hyenas killing baby leopards. The hyena is going to walk past the front of the vehicle in front of us. And there he is. I think that's one of our viewers on the back of that car. Very friendly as she came in today, shouted at me while we were live. I had to give her a stern look. Maddie, a hyena and painted dog are completely, completely different animals. In fact, as we often say, the leopard is more closely related to this hyena than it is, or than the hyena is, to paint a dog or wild dog. So it's paintable for wild dog. And they are dogs, they're canids, very closely related to domestic dogs and wolves and jackals and that sort of thing, whereas a hyena is in a totally separate family. So they are really, I mean, if you saw one next to this hyena, Maddie, you'd never mistake them. A hyena looks like a dog and is superficially like a dog. You know, its claws are out all the time. But it's actually, if you want to find the closest related carnivores, they're mongoose and that sort of thing. Alrighty, let's go back to the Vov and get an update from him. I will try and get into a position where we can view these leopards more easily.
Thanks, James.
Well, we're still bumbling along. Haven't managed to come along any tracks of wild dogs. I saw something just now that looked kind of like a wild dog track, but there was only one. In the sand, in the soft, wet sand, it could have been a hyena. I'm just going to keep going along here. You never know, we might be lucky, but the ground is not ideal for tracking. We'll still do what we can. Also the light, it's pretty low light. Keep our eyes peeled. That's okay. James is having a whale of a time. We're going to find our own stuff, aren't we, Owen?
Absolutely.
Absolutely. So there are definitely lions on Little Gowrie. I don't know who they are. Could be the sticks, it could also be the Nkuhumas. Unfortunately, we can't go there. And there's no report of wild dogs, so. Puma, it could very well have rained enough for the termites. It's really hard to say. I mean, sometimes you get rain and the termites pop out, sometimes you get rain and they don't. So I know environmental conditions do play a major role, but what specifically, how much rain do they expect beforehand? So, very interesting. We'll keep looking. Lots of termite mounds around. I haven't seen any alates as of yet. Maybe a little bit more rain will be needed to really wet the ground. Make it easier for the king and queens that do exit after their nuptial flight to then be able to dig into the ground. Very difficult to do so if the ground is very, very hard. And with only 3 mils of rain yesterday, everybody, that's minuscule. Minuscule amounts of rain, just enough to make everybody wet and uncomfortable. But hopefully, because it was soft and gentle, it's going to benefit the vegetation, especially the grass. Going to get warm again today, back up to 31 degrees Celsius, so back into the 90s Fahrenheit. Quite common for this time of year. So apart from our kudu, it's been a pretty quiet, oh, here we go. We found ourselves another animal, just on the right here. Owen, get in a nice spot for you. It's not the best of views. Let me go ahead. No, we're not gonna get a very good view of this guy. This girl. See if I can get you a spot through the thickets. Yeah, I know. I know the pole is in the way. one of the things when it rains, everybody, we need this roof. You need to be prepared in case it rains, otherwise all of our expense... Are you happy there?
Yeah.
Are you sure? Okay. There we go, we've got a waterbuck hiding in the thickets. Now, directly behind the waterbuck, the direction its bottom is facing, is Chitwa. And as we know, waterbuck are never too far away from Chitwa watering hole. And since the wild dogs cleaned up all the baby waterbuck in the last few months, I haven't seen a young waterbuck at all. Only adults, females and males, busy chewing, chopping up that grass, maximize the digestion. And the rest of your family. Not common to find a female on her own. And if you do, it's generally due to the fact that they've got baby hiding somewhere. Now, not the most amazing view of a waterbuck. I'm sure we can do better. Let's move on. The waterbuck will be quite excited for the rain to be able to flush the grass back again. Bulk grazers, they need lots and lots of juicy wet grass. Anyway, James is still with his leopard duo. I wonder what other action might unfold.
Well, not much. Everything's calmed down now. Tingana is sitting in his breakfast tree. He seems to be such a champion sleeper that he's able to go into a sort of coma no matter how uncomfortable he looks. I mean, there must be countless sticks spiking him, sticking into his sides and making his old joints and bones quite sore. But he careth not. Now there's a squirrel shouting off towards the right-hand side of your picture, and that is because Talamba is off to the right, possibly about to murder another one of its conspecifics. That's not a great picture, David. Shall we try and find Talamba? I think that Talamba is possibly showing signs of a first estrus. I don't know, but I suspect that, I think as with most of these cats, you know, a heat or an estrus, the first one is not really a real one. They just sort of feel the first flushes of the hormone. I don't think they ovulate. I don't think there's a thickening of the endometrium that is sufficient to implant an embryo. But, you know, that kind of, I don't know, if you've ever seen a cat in heat, it's pretty obvious when you see it again. And to me, it looked a little bit like her behavior, her arched back, and the way she was rubbing herself against that tree made me think, maybe. You got it? About two. Across the valley. Close? Far? Oh. That's very good, David. Magnificent shot. Hello, Talamba. I doubt she'll be there for long. She'll be moving around a lot. Sam, she didn't really, you know. It was pretty normal age. The males tend to stay with their mother slightly longer, but, you know, when I got here 4 years ago, the standard that I had seen and that you'd read about was that the females would be with their youngsters for around about 18 months to 2 years. But over here, It's always been slightly earlier than that that the youngsters have either been forced into independence or have gone independent. It can happen as young as 8 months, and in her particular case, it happened just after a year. Let me just roll slightly forward. See, I've improved your picture immeasurably, David. So I don't think that she went into independent necessarily to very young. Although at the time, of course, when we thought Tundi was first coming into Estrus, I think Talamba was only a year old, which did seem a bit young. But it happens. And maybe it's all just part of the, you know, the process of separation. You know, she's done absolutely fine, hasn't she? She hasn't struggled even for a day. Well, I'm sure she has, but not obviously so. You hear the lovely sound of the grey-headed bushrike there. No, Laura Lee, most mammals... In fact, I don't know of another one that menstruates. Most mammals reabsorb the endometrium. So when she has a proper estrus, there will be a thickening of the endometrium, just like there is in human beings. But instead of it then flushing out of the body, what it will do is just be reabsorbed. And I don't know, I think there are other mammals who menstruate like we do, but most reabsorb it, and so there isn't this loss of... I mean, it's very expensive to menstruate. I'm sure there are very good reasons, physiological reasons for it. I'm not sure what they are. But, yeah, most mammals don't do that. Human beings are relatively on their own in that respect. Not sure if any of the great apes do it. She's not going to win us any Emmy Awards. Let's just give her another 5 or 10 minutes and see if she stands up and starts leaping up and down trees again. Before we decide to move on. Dory, probably not very successful, but remember, leopard mothers are not very successful generally because the chances of them raising cubs to adulthood are so small, given the incredible risks that baby leopards face. So, I don't know. I'm not sure that she would necessarily be unsuccessful, but I think like anything, it takes a little bit of time to learn. But at the same time, I'm not sure the cognitive ability to learn something like that over a long period. So, you know, if baby raising for these cats is very much an instinctual process. And if she, for example, loses a baby to a hyena in her first litter, she might learn that that's a risk to baby cubs. I mean, she'll probably know that anyway. But she won't learn about other sorts of risks to cubs because, you know, if she loses the cub straight away to one cause, she won't learn about the myriad other ones, which means that much of her ability to protect a cub comes from instinct, from her own sense of danger and the things that she's learned and is instinctually aware of that are dangerous to her. See the fallen log there? There's a nightjar just sitting on the end of it. I'm not sure what flushed it. If you... No, we're on the wrong part of the world. Come back a bit. See this big tree here?
Yep,
there. It's right on the end of my finger. Is it? No, it's not. It's just beyond that. Yeah, up a bit. No, you can't, Louise. You definitely can't see it. Louise says she can see a nightjar on that picture. She can't. zoom out a bit, and then that branch there, zoom in there, up a bit. Yeah, you got it. Do you? Yeah, you do, it's behind the stick. Yeah, you can just see it there. There we go. Nice little night job. Tlalumba Mr. Two, it will be pleased about that. Not sure which nightjar that is. Identifying them like that's very hard. Okay, Tlalumba's just behind us. I suppose I should try and reverse, shouldn't I, David? You know, often the directors in the final control see things before we do. I know it's a little embarrassing, but they do. And they'll say, yeah, and there's just top left of screen, and we'll go, huh? But that wasn't one occasion. Ah, yes. And Chris Rogue, you identified that hyena as Fika, not Tsaka. Thank you for that. She's still chuffing away at her dad, wasting her time. Let's go back to the Volv. He is on the tracks and very kindly given me the sighting.
I am attempting to track.
Got some hippo tracks in the road. They're the easiest things to see at this time of day. They're huge feet, boom, 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 making a big mark in the sand. But we're not tracking hippos this morning. We are trying to find any other tracks. There's a beautiful. This is where a rhinoceros has laid down. Just move over for you. You can show it. Jump off. Have a little look. So lovely to see the body shape of these animals. Lots of feet. Here was a body in the sand. You see the feet are over here. More feet. And then two of them lay here. Can you see this here, Owen? You can actually see the little skin, the lines of the body, where his back was in here. And then his body went forward with his face over here. So this is from the horn of a rhino. Can you see that? From the horn, and then you've got the legs and the body. Ah, two of them. One lay there, one lay over here. Very cool to see. I don't know if it's that clear from your angle there, but from the top here, it's very, 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 very well designed. See the wrinkly body. Very cool. Well, I'm going to jump back on with my wonderful gumboots. It's just that kind of weather. Keep your feet nice and dry. I often find rhino tracks. They've been having a nap. Linda, I will indeed watch out for lions. I always do. I'm always watching out. I just don't always see them. Typical boy look. Ever heard the term boy look before, Owen?
Yeah.
Boy look, you know, you're looking in your cupboard for an item of clothing, or you're looking in the fridge for a very specific thing. I can't find it! And you get so annoyed. Girlfriend or mum or friend or whoever it is like, but it's right there in the middle. No, can't find it. And then when you come and have a look, they find it right in the middle of the shelf. And Lou's saying men look with their mouths, not their eyes. Prob- probably right, Lou. You're probably right. I suppose we can condition ourselves out of doing boy looks. Okay, well, with James having the two leopards in one sighting, we've got the entire entire property of Juma to search, and we've managed to find ourselves some spots now in the form of a beautiful giraffe. I know many of you out there are always very excited when we show you giraffe, and here we have found a magnificent boy. To reach down for what looks like a small... Well, he doesn't have to reach as far as the kudu. That's why giraffe always doing quite well this time of year. Before the flush, they're already getting the tallest of the trees. Then with his neck being able to stretch down like that, also be able to eat the same angle as that of the kudu, or the same height. You never really see giraffe in poor condition. And evolutionary evolvement of them getting that long neck has led to them doing quite well. They can reach the tallest of trees and they can bend right down to the height of an impala. And also with that long neck, they can even stick their face right into a bush. Off he goes, wandering off. We'll continue on. Abby, they do saunter, don't they? They are the saunterers of the bush. Two left legs move and then the two right legs. It's a constant process. I enjoy it when they run. Watching giraffe run is quite special. Cover quite some distance in a very short period of time with enormously long stride. A tasty boy. Not really. Little nibble, next bush. Tree have we got there? Yeah, it's the russet bush willow. Susan, they look like they're quite slow when they run, but it's because it requires a lot of energy to move that massive body. But when they run, they move like the wind. It doesn't look like they're going fast, but the length of those legs and the stride with which they can, or the gait which with they can stretch out, means they can cover distance very quickly. Obviously sprinting, they're not as fast as lion or leopard, but they can carry on at probably about 50 odd, 55 kilometers an hour for quite some distance. So about 27, close to 30 miles an hour. And it works in two ways, because when the giraffe is running, they actually pump their diaphragm. So it's very interesting. Giraffe lungs actually fill up that entire chest cavity, but the chest cavity and the ribs are not movable like ours. A giraffe is not able to expand its ribs. Its ribs are there to keep its body together. And how do they expand and contract their diaphragm? And it's very interesting, because when the giraffe is at full in-breath, the entire chamber in within the rib cage is filled with oxygen in the lungs, and as they move forward, the front legs hitting the ground actually pumps the diaphragm back, which forces the air out of their nostrils, and then as they stride forward again, the diaphragm moves back again, expands, and as they pump forward again, the front legs pump back on the chest and push the air out. So when they run, they actually they're at risk of overheating if they're not able to pump the air in and out. And with
those massive nostrils and the action of the body pumping and the legs moving at high speed actually causes the in and out flow of breath. Because most animals, you'll see when you watch them breathing, you see the ribs expanding and contracting. But in giraffe, they can't do that. So they do would run the risk of being able to sort of overheat at higher speeds. But when they run, it's almost effortless once they get going. And the youngsters are able to keep up with the full gallop of the adults from an early age, because they're born with their legs already at two-thirds of the sort of length which they're going to be as an adult. So they're born with very, very long legs, and their stunted neck slowly but surely catches up. Very good. Well, we're losing our giraffe into the thicket. He's enjoying himself a little bit of breakfast. I'm going to move on. Shelly, you want to know, giraffes have mating season. They don't necessarily have a season, but there's definitely a peak. Like we find with many of our animals, it's a 14-month gestation period. So it's quite a long time in the belly, but there's not a peak. They're called aggregations, so loose aggregations or associations. They don't stick out together, but the females want to have their youngsters sort of in the summer months, like many of our antelope choose to do when the vegetation is at its best, so that there's enough to be able to provide for the mum and her milk and to be able to keep a little baby going. But you can find giraffe calves being born any time of year. But definitely there'll be a peak towards the spring and summer months. So it's really only kudu, not kudu, wildebeest and impala here that have a very specific time of year. And all the other animals can be throughout the year, but there are peaks when the conditions are more favorable. Okay, well, James is still with Tlalamba. I wonder if she's going to snack on something more than just her squirrel.
No, she's going to snack on the bitterness of having her meal stolen. That's all that she's going to snack on right now. Her father hasn't moved. She's come out and is lying under a bush. David, I'm feeling the spattering of rain on the back of my neck. What about you?
Me too.
Are you? We'd better close up all of our equipment. I'm going to put my illegal camera into its box. We were going to walk this morning, everyone, but on account of the inclemency of the weather, we thought perhaps it's a better idea to be in the vehicle. I think that people should learn to make waterproof cameras, is what I think. Marcel, unsurprisingly, from the final control, says he has a waterproof camera in the final control. Marcel, is it a wildlife camera? Does it have a long lens on it that is waterproof? No, is the answer. He says he can put a long lens on it. A waterproof lens, Marcel. He says, yup. And now he's looking very smug. This is the man. Let me just inform you of something. Yesterday, we were discussing the chances of Tundi's cubs surviving, which, of course, we know are very small. And he then went on to give us a fairly lengthy treatise on the Slavic cultural norms around the burying of a dead child. How on earth he knew any of this is completely beyond me and most people. Everyone just stared at him in slightly gobsmacked amazement, but regularly out of Marcel's mouth comes some obscure bit of trivia that you think that cannot be true, and so you go and check it up, and sure as nuts it is. Anyway, if you ever want to know about the norms around burying dead children in Slavic culture, Marcel's your man. sleepy. I don't think it's worth leaving her, though, because, well, you know, it's pretty rainy and miserable out there. And we're enjoying ourselves here. David, you're wondering if I'm going to get some moist cake for my birthday. I hope not. What I'm hoping for, and what I've demanded from Amanda, and I've reminded her, she's our chef, by the way, I've reminded her on a weekly basis that today is a very important day. I'm hoping that there is going to be apple crumble for my pudding this evening. That's what I'm hoping for. I'm also fervently hoping that no one will attempt to make another vegan cake for the camp, because I will be unable to eat it. I'll have to go and sit in my room for the rest of the day. Delicious vegan cake. Like I say, tasted a bit like floral sawdust. Marcel, too, is having traumatic flashbacks of vegan cake, and apparently, you know, if Marcel is having a flashback and a bad experience of some kind of sugary kind of food, then you know it was bad, because basically if it's got sugar in it, he'll eat it. Or meat. Just the gentle chorus of a few hornbills in the background. Yes, many of you are saying yum for apple crumble, and Amanda makes a mean one. She makes little baby ones and puts them in the muffin cooker, what's they called? Muffin tray. And when she does make, every so often after I've begged, it's normally a sort of 2-month begging process which results in their creation. I eat one and then hide one for the morning to have with my coffee. Normally David finds it before that I manage to eat it though. She's still sort of awake, so I think it's worth sitting around here. Hey, Talamba. Cam Hopper, there's a lot of kill left, a lot of meat. I'll tell you what, I'll try and get an angle of it. I think you can get it from here. David thinks that his skills are sufficient for us to get the kill from right where we are. Much venison steak left. How he can sleep in that tree. David, you're the only other organism I know that is able to sleep like Tingana. Do you think that you could sleep up in that tree?
It'd be a challenge.
I would think that you probably could. If I know anyone who could achieve it, it would be you. A skill that you could sell. I can sleep anywhere. Are you able to sleep on an aeroplane?
Of course.
With great ease. You feel well rested after a 10-hour flight, do you? It's wonderful. I was, Louise. I was guiding a plane to land. It was because of my outlandishly bright jacket. As all of you can see, all of you safari goers can see, camouflage is very important when you're sitting on a vehicle because the animals are terrified and react to all sorts of colours. I'm, of course, being entirely facetious. This bright red jacket has not made a great deal of difference to this cat's life this morning. You can see she's not attracted to it, nor is she frightened by it. I probably wouldn't wear it if I was walking. Oh, there she goes. Little stretch. I'm now going to have to reposition the vehicle. Let's just let her make a pee-pee. Doing lots of that around here. It's either territorial or estrus, or proto-estrus. I don't think it's full estrus at all. Okay, we're going to move the car. You're going to go back to the Wolf, who's slightly better camouflaged than me. He's also got Wellington boots on.
Dude, I think James is a bit jealous of my boots, to be honest. Everyone sees my boots, they go, oh, I wish I had your boots. I like my boots. They do the job. Wonderful for in the rain, they're nice and warm, sheep's wool inside, comfortable. Got my gloves on now, it's pretty cold this morning. I told Owen it was going to be fresh, he was taking his jersey off before we even left camp. I was like, oh, I'd leave that on, Owen, and now he's with his shorts and his thin little jerseys, feeling rather cold. Should put a Senzor. Senzor always used to have about 3 blankets on the back and his beanies and all his jackets. I don't even know how I used to move back there. Okay, so last night apparently, or yesterday morning, Tundi / Kuchava was seen with a kill on the eastern boundary. We couldn't get there. Driven past again, but we're now slowly just moving through the area where Tundi's denning, just along the road. We're not going in at all to the den, but seeing if maybe she's around, maybe we can get a view. Haven't seen her since the day before. When then James found, was it James? Tristan, of course it was Tristan. Owen watches the show, he knows. He's like, oh, it's Tristan. Who can forget James's afternoon that day of him being very upset that somebody else, other than him, found Tundi's cub? We're still not sure if it's a plural or not. Very quiet, no tracks here. I'm going to go around the other side. Oh, aren't we all looking forward to meeting whatever she's hiding in her little burrow or little den? All very excited for that. It'll be a proper baby boomer year if we do get to see her soon. Remember the Juma clan went through their breeding peak? The Nkuhumas have gone through theirs, and now the one and only Queen Tundi. So very exciting times for us here on Juma. I know it's somewhere in there. I haven't physically seen it myself, but I have an idea of where it is. I always just sort of drive around the outskirts and see if there's any tracks coming in. Any tracks coming out. I mean, a leopard was tracked from this road, Batele, heading east, dragging what I think might have been a python. When I was listening on the radio, I didn't see it or anything, I just heard. What a bad year for pythons this year has been. Tingana, we know, has eaten 2, and possibly Tundi eating another one. But why she dragged it all the way there, all the way east? possibly... Possibly if she's got a den here, she maybe wants to take the food away from the den so it doesn't attract the nosy hyenas. Or maybe she's moved the den already to that side. We don't know. Just keep checking. Some lovely blue-eared starlings there, Owen. Let's do some birding, shall we? Birds on the floor. They're looking for some insects. They're hoping this rain is going to soften the ground up to provide some wonderful alates. See how they hop lovely across the ground there. See the very dark blue patch behind the ear, called the ear covert, and the orange eye, and a sort of a greeny back with a sort of a bluey belly in the light as it changes. But you can easily see how they've got that very dark patch behind the ear. Kim, this is one of your favorite birds, the greater blue-eared starling. And we were talking about the honey guide earlier. Honey guides will choose starlings as a brood parasite. And they lay their eggs in their nest, and then the starlings do all of the work. Just the smallest of leaves, leaf flitting. Underneath the leaves, all the insects are hidden away. Looks very busy, doesn't it? That could be ants. When you see a bird plucking away like that, they've possibly unearthed an ant nest. Ants are quite busy after rain, because their burrows often get inundated with moisture, and you'll often find a whole colony of ants moving away, moving their egg casings, their pupa, somewhere where it's dry. Can you see anything on the floor there, Owen? I can't see any ants. But if it is the pieces of wood that it's moving, it could also be some of the termites that you find just decaying any pieces of wood. There we go. You can actually see there's termites there just below its belly, the little white guys. Many times people call termites the white ant, but they are in fact not ants, termites. And it would be around underneath these little bits of wood, busy decomposing them. Oh, there are some ants as well. I can see them running around on the right-hand side. Maybe those little white things were indeed the pupa that the ants were moving around. Once their den, as I said, gets inundated, you often find them, the entire community, carrying away their progeny and family members to find a new den that hasn't had a rainfall event. Yummy, like peanuts. Peanuts with a little bit of an acidic taste. What have you got? Oh, here we go. Everyone's commenting on how beautiful the iridescence is, and it is very, very pretty. The carotenoids in the feathers, and that is what adds the reflection. There's not actually a true pigment there, just carotenoids combined with melanin. That's why in the right light you get this beautiful blue-green reflection, and in the poor light they go quite dark black. But that iridescence assists them a lot in sort of keeping them from getting too hot in the sun. And a very nice specialized feeding ability to be able to walk around on the ground. Clue in, I don't know if it's a male or female. I mean, the starlings are very, very similar. There's probably a very slight size difference. But without them being right next to each other, it's impossible for me to tell you who's the male and female. But it's definitely a breeding pair hanging out together. Probably getting ready for the breeding season to happen. Insects will be abounding. And I'll probably find a cavity in a tree somewhere created by a woodpecker or barbet. And hopefully no honey guides parasitize on them.
see the ants on the floor there? Can you see them all, everybody? A couple little ants. Just a morsel or two. Almost as small, I suppose, if you compare the body size with that of Columba and her squirrel.
Here we have got Columba, who has moved down the bank a little bit. We parked under Tingana for a brief while to see if we could get a picture, but we didn't get a decent view of him. Nevertheless, here he is, right now. Not him, sorry, her. Lying peacefully in the open on a bank. If you do hear some growling, that is my stomach. Very peaceful now. Totally peaceful. One or two Franklins calling. Cecil, he'll probably come down from time to time from the tree, but I don't know what he'll do. In other words, he might sort of decide he needs some morning toilet and do what he needs to do, and then probably go off back up to the tree. He might come and lie beneath it if he thinks that he can stay unharassed by his daughter. But as soon as he leaves that tree, and if he's not around, she will go back up there and try and take whatever there is, because that's what they do. That's why she's here. Oh, as Louise says, we have also seen Tingana make toilet from a tree before. Yes, that is cannot be denied. He's not shy of going to the loo out of a tree. She is very nice and relaxed now, though. Second chance crafting. Tingana is much bigger than Columba. I would say about double the mass. I'd say she's about 30 kilos, and I'd put him at around about 70 or so, maybe a little bit more than that. But he is substantially larger than her. That's why she won't attempt to try and take the kill from him. He's just too big. And again, I'm going to suggest we stay here because I can't see her. I can't see her staying lying down like that too long, so worth just being patient about it, I think. And if you're desperate for me to move along so that we can drive and look at things, then we can do that, but I don't think we should. Second chance crafting saying it's a big difference. Yeah, it is. It absolutely is a big difference, but it's normal. In most, or in many species, it's quite
quite interesting, the difference between in sizes between male and female is a predictor, or not a predictor, it's a function probably of their social structure, and a predictor of their social structure to a certain extent. So in a species like this, where the male is substantially larger than the female, obviously he dominates her and he dominates the social circle, but he will also monopolize mating opportunities within a certain area. So it's unlikely, well, it's not impossible, it's unlikely that she will mate with a male outside of his territory. And that's why he's got this huge size, so that he can fight off anyone that comes into his territory to try and mate with his ladies. She might go out of his territory to mate, that's possible. And now, of course, the inevitable discussion of incest must come up. It is entirely likely, of course, in this particular case. But it's not a problem for the cats. Not morally and not biologically. Diana, she might mate with Hukumuri or Mulwati, but she lives in Tingana's territory at the moment, and Tingana is still a territorial male leopard. He is showing no signs, really, of letting go of his territory. Every time another male comes in here, suddenly Tingana reappears and starts sawing and making a big noise. That's precisely what happened when Mulwati last arrived at the pan. So, you know, I can't see it happening unless she goes and seeks them out, which is possible. I think many of you are secretly hoping for a romance between Hukumuri and Tlalamba. And Tlalamba would be wise to think carefully about such a tryst, because if she gives birth to Hukumuri's baby in Tingana's territory, well, it could be very dangerous if he smells a rat, as it were. If he feels he's been cuckolded at all. And remember, her grandmother, so her grandfather was also her great-grandfather. Her grandfather was also her great-grandfather, as I've said before. So her grandmother, Karula's father was also Karula's grandfather. So incest runs in this family, and quite successfully so. Patty, I don't think there's any chance that she's pregnant. No, I mean, look, it's not impossible. We obviously had no idea that Tandy was pregnant until about 3 days before she gave birth. But I don't think that this young cat is pregnant. I think we'd have seen more obvious signs of oestrus before now. Right, here we shall remain. And Vov is not remaining, he is moving.
We are indeed moving. Haven't managed to find any fresh activity of a female leopard going in and out of that den area. Bearing in mind, she's probably quite secretive going in and out. And she's got such delicate little feet, little Tandy, so quite hard to see her tracks in the sand unless she walks in the road. Oh. Lovely overcast day today. I know it's going to get warmer, but it's one of those days that after breakfast, you just climb back into bed and just pull the duvets around. It was very cool. The last week or so, getting back from morning drive, it's so hot already. It's already in the 30s, in the 90s. and all you want to do is have a shower. Just cool off. But a day like this, a nice coffee and a hearty breakfast and a little morning snooze is definitely the way forward. Owen agrees, he's going to do the same thing. Okay, we can actually look all the way in the distance, Owen. You see the cloud bank over there. Is that all right?
Yeah, nice.
You can see the cloud bank. The low felt is all overcast and cloudy. And just through that gap, you can actually see sort of the mountain. Well, that dark patch, I'm assuming, is the mountain, but these clouds will all back up against the mountain, and the dew point is created by the moisture heading up. Once it hits the mountain, it sort of goes upward. It hits the dew point, which is a specific temperature in the atmosphere, at which point the water vapor turns into moisture, and then it forms cloud and pushes back into the low felt, and that is what creates the rain. So if you ever do the panorama route, which is basically going from here to Hoedspruit and up onto the mountain, there's a wonderful number of viewpoints, one called God's Window, a number of other places you can go and have a look. But when the conditions are like this, there's no point in going up because all you'll see is cloud. The mountains will be shrouded in moisture and cloud. And it's why on the mountains we get so much more sort of moist, temperate forest. In certain areas, it's because of that amount of moisture vapor that accumulates as the cloud sort of runs up and down the face of the mountain itself. So you always get a higher rainfall towards the escarpment than away from it. So a little bit further north towards Anin is a beautiful forest mountain region there, and lots of fruit farming. It gets very tropical as you get closer to the mountain. The Drakensberg Mountain, also translated to mean the Dragon's Back Mountain, runs all around in a half moon of South Africa. Well, very good. Let's carry on. Cecil, looks like the setting for the Lion King. Everything the light touches is your kingdom. Something like that. The new Lion King movie is out, I believe. It's very good. Now, you can't go to the dark, shadowy place, Lou. That's not your kingdom. Don't go to the dark, shadowy place. Whoopi Goldberg is there. Whoopi Goldberg laughing. That was always funny. Whoopi Goldberg was a hyena, a Lion King. Do you remember that? She had quite a laugh on her. I believe the new movie is very good. I haven't seen it yet. Okay, well, we keep heading along here. We're doing huge amounts of circles, trying to cover the whole property. There's only one Juma vehicle out. I've heard no landowners from the north. So it's basically the Vorv and Owen driving around Juma. James is obviously static with his wonderful sighting. We're expending the energy and the fuel this morning. Neil, we see them regularly, tracks all the time, lots and lots of tracks, lots of activity. And they're quite relaxed actually here, very, very relaxed. Saw one last night, had quite a few on foot, a little youngster yesterday, yeah. Okay, so we're going to slowly head back in a westerly direction now. I know most of these roads I drove yesterday, so quite interesting to see the freshness of tracks on top of vehicle tracks. As I know when I drove here, so if I find anything on top of my tires, I've got a good idea of whenabouts it was. So one of the advantages of being out on a number of drives is you actually have a handle of who's been where and what's done what. With quite a few presenters in camp, sometimes you get a few shifts off. It's not a bad thing having a shift off. It's quite nice to catch up on things. But when you come out, you feel completely lost as to what's going on. Dave Sprite, you say you would like me to solve a debate. The debate is, are there piranhas in Africa? We've got an elephant on the right-hand side. Dave, there's no piranhas in Africa. As far as I'm aware, piranhas occur in the Amazon. In the Amazon River, maybe some of the other rivers as well. We've got at least two elephants over here. Let me just get you in a nice spot there, Owen. Looks like he's a little bit backed up. Is that going to work? Tell me when. No piranhas in Africa. There's crocodiles. Crocodiles eat the meat in Africa, in the waters. Piranhas are, as far as I'm aware, only occur in South America. I could be wrong, but that's the only place I've heard of. I've never seen piranhas before. Obviously, the movies make them out to be very, very bad. I suppose like some movies make lions and elephants out to be very bad as well, and then a lot of people come to Africa with this false. What's going on with your radio, Owen? Sounds like Owen's radio has just switched off. Maybe just restart your radio and put it on again. Yeah, my radio is working. I think Owen's. Did you get her comms there? Okay. Suddenly had this like, which is generally that low battery warning you get on certain radios. So I think piranhas have been demonified. Is that the right word? They've been made out to be the villain. I don't think they're really as bad as all that. Demonized. Thank you, Lou. Thank you. Thank you very much, Lou, for being right there in my earphone, friend. So I think they've been made out to be worse than they really are. They feed on meat. And they supposedly terrorize people. But I think what they do is they clean up the mess like crocodiles do. They remove any unwanted organic material in the form of animal remains. I don't think it's as bad as you dip your toe and it comes out without any meat on it. But then, I'm no expert in the piranha. But with all Hollywood, everything is made out to be a little bit worse than it really is. This very relaxed elephant bull is enjoying himself a stick. He's taking after Talamba this morning. She was thoroughly enjoying playing with her stick. Yes, indeed. These are piranha of trees right here. They're just destroying all the trees as they feed. There's a beautiful bull. Goes your radio again. Sorry, Owen, I don't know what that is. It might be some battery issue. Okay, well, from the piranha of the trees down here in the eastern side of Juma, let's send you over to the piranha of squirrels.
She ain't up to nothing right now. She's just sleeping. Her daddy doing the same thing. I don't know why I'm talking like this. I just am. Perhaps it's because I like to say the word piranha. Piranha, piranha. You ever seen a piranha? I never seen no piranha here in Africa. A piranha. It gone bit me on my foot when I was swimming down the Amazon. And them piranha took off my baby foot when I'd been swimming down the Amazon River. My baby toe off my left foot. Okay, we're gonna go back to the daddy leopard now because he looked like he's moving around. Daddy leopard, up you get. We're coming for a visit. Get on your game, son. Daddy Leopard was moving around, but Daddy Leopard now not moving around anymore. He doing his championship sleeping job. Let's try to get that great shot over there. David? How about that? Might be able to get his face. Yes, makeup girl, that is my idea. I'm a deep southern birthday cowboy today who talks about being chewed up by piranhas in the Amazon River. Just after my beans and chicory for breakfast. Let me just tell you what happened on this vehicle. Louise just sent through a comment that some viewers are impressed by my accent, so I thought that was very nice. As she said that, David behind me went, "Oh." You did. I heard you.
I had a chuckle.
To say, I've heard this for so long now, and it's just all too much. And please don't encourage him further. Sure, pal. Maybe it was the thought of beans for breakfast, David. Mm-hmm. Oh, Cobalt, a lot of money. To have my voice as your car navigation. It depends, I guess, how many words I'd have to read out. I think about a quarter a word would go down quite well, so you know, four words for a dollar. Cobalt, turn left here, boy. I could add some insults to it. It'd be quite fun if you were driving along and suddenly you went over the speed limit. Slow down, son. You're gonna kill someone. Slow down, son. Your carbon footprint is increasing. That's a glorious shot. All right, let's move a little bit closer. I'm just going to have to sort of vary our movements around here a bit to see if we can get a decent view of Sleepy Daddy. Not ideal, really, is it? We'll spend 2 minutes here. His daughter is bound to get up at some stage. Ruth? Leopard and lion territories always overlap, and it's one of the things, and I mean, look, I stand to be corrected here, but there was a recent BBC show called Dynasties, which disappointed me in some respects, because when I watched the wild dog video, they showed this sophisticated, no doubt massively expensive graphic, where they had two wild dog territories, a lion territory and a hyena territory, as exclusive to each other. Now,
I am unaware of any part of the world where predator territories do not overlap with each other. They occupy different niches, and because they occupy different niches, they do have overlapping territories. So Tingana and Tlalamba live inside the territory of the Nkuhuma pride. So it's, well, I mean, they don't live, they live in it. And they will avoid trying to encounter the lions. They also live in the territory of the Juma clan of hyenas. And they also live in the territory of the Avoca males. And they live in the territory of, well, I mean, the wild dogs here are not particularly territorial, but, you know, in theory, what else is territorial? Tingana lives in the territory also of whatever honey badger happens to be in this area. I suppose Tingana's territory would be much bigger than the honey badger, so you could say, well, the honey badger lives in Tingana's territory. But they absolutely overlap. They must. The only difference, or the only time where they don't overlap, is where predators occupy a very similar trophic or food niche, and where the competition is too great for them to overlap. And one of the examples of that, apparently, is tigers and Amur leopards. I don't know if it happens in India, but up in Russia when I was there, they said you very, very seldom see the Amur leopard and tigers in the same area. They don't seem to occur together. One would assume because the pressure exerted on the leopard is too great from the tigers, but I think there are parts of India where absolutely they occur in the same place. Although it wouldn't be that surprising to not find them the same in the same place, because they both sort of are woodland, thicket, forest-dwelling animals that eat small, medium, and large antelope. Okay, let's go back to the wolf. He has now got an animal, which is fantastic.
Well, we had the elephants there. They've just gone a little bit too far into the bush. So three big bulls just popped in on this little game path, see if we could get a good view. And we had one feeding nicely, and now the giant behemoth of an animal has just turned and disappeared into the bushes. Amazing how they can disappear like that. So sorry, I'm not going to show you again. Three elephant bulls taking it very easy this morning. There were a breeding herd of elephant tracks. Remember, we found the kudu. We were following some tracks there earlier of a herd, but they went all the way out south. So we started trying to find tracks of the wild dogs coming in. To no avail. There have been lots of elephants around of late. I'm sure a lot of that's got to do with the water near our camps. I know we showed you these battelier yesterday, but why not? We've got an adult and the juvenile is off to the right of it. Let's see if I get you in a nice position there, Owen. There's the adult battelier on the left, and on the right-hand side of the tree is the juvenile, which was, I believe, from last year's breed, or earlier this year's brood. There's the battelier. Dark coloration, and then on the opposite tree to the right hand side is the juvenile. There we go, it's a female. Very white shoulder pads. Very beautiful face on the battaliers. See the wings overlapping behind and just touching underneath the pole or the stump that they're on. You don't see the tail. So the tips of the wings very sharp and joining underneath the bottom with no tail evident. And now if we have a look at the juvenile is essentially a battelier with training wheels. So they've got a tail. There we go, just to the right of the screen there. You'll see that it's brown. The wings also come down and touch, but you'll see that in amongst there, oh, you can't see it now, there is a tail in there. Very brown. It's okay, probably going to be a male, this one. There you can see the tail now, right at the bottom. They need training wheels when they start flying, otherwise the ability of them to fly would be very difficult. They have to learn how to fly with no tail or very short tail. Otherwise, they stall. And when they stall, they'll just fall out of the sky. So this little youngster will learn, and the tail will get shorter and shorter as it gets into breeding plumage. It looks like it's eating something. Yeah. Oh, there we go. I wonder what it's got. I wonder what it's been provided. They are very good scavengers, bateliers. Who knows if it caught it itself? That might have been provided by the adult, seeing as the adult is sitting quite close by in attendance. That's where raptors get their name. Well, raptors are all defined by birds with a sharp meat-eating beak, as well as a very, very well-adapted foot for holding, clasping, and also breaking the spine of certain prey species. Most other birds aren't able to do what raptors do and hold food like that. And the shrikes will actually attach prey to thorns, which enable them to create a larder of sorts and also to enable them to rip the insects apart that is attached to the thorn. So it works quite well. It's almost like a clamp or a vise that holds something in place while it rips. And all the birds of prey are able to do this, hold something and then rip it, because birds of prey often catch or feed on items of food that are larger than they can physically swallow, whereas most other birds have a pretty much a food diet requirement that is sort of easily swallowed in one go. Well, every now and again you find kingfishers that bite off a little bit more than they can chew and struggle to swallow the entire fish whole. Exactly. Just like my bee eater with its dragonfly the other day. We never saw it physically finish that dragonfly. Might have beaten it to a pulp before then deciding to give it to its girlfriend. Birds alarming behind me. I'm trying to have a look and see what's causing them to be upset. Don't think it's the birds of prey. You can hear that shh, shh, shh. It's called fishing. It's a sound that we often do, well, I often do, to attract birds out of concealed places. It's a sound that birds will make when they've spotted some form of predator. It goes something like this. Hello, Dave Sprite. You want to know why there's so many nests in that tree? Well, let's start with the one at the bottom in the bark itself, in the middle of the stump. Can you see that one in the middle? Yeah, that was a bateleur nest there in the fork of the tree. You can just see it sort of on the left. That was a bateleur nest. And the other nests are all buffalo weaver, red-billed buffalo weaver. So they're the bateleur nests in the cavity of the tree, quite deep inside the canopy, because they breed in the summer months when their eggs would get cooked, as well as the chicks. And those other nests in the top are buffalo weavers, which are community nest building birds that they'll live in all year round. Actually, not this tree, but the one just down the road actually had the bateleurs on that nest earlier this year. And there was a buffalo weaver coming down and stealing the sticks from the bateleurs' nest to attach it to their own nest. They use very similar nesting material. Although the buffalo weaver is at least able to knit them together in a form of a weaved nest, whereas all your large raptors, with the inability to really build a nest, they just build the sort of platform of sticks on the top of a tree. And dependent on the time of year that they breed, will depend on the amount of cover they require. So both the Warburgs, as well as the Batelier, have nests quite deep in the canopy of a tree due to the fact that they breed when the larger predatory birds are not breeding and the sun is shining. It gets very hot in summer. Most of our predatory birds will actually breed in the winter. Okay, everybody, well, we're going to carry on down this drainage line. Who knows what we might find, but let's send you back over to the birthday girl. Boy.
Birthday girl. I don't think she's got a birthday just yet, David. I think let's go back to the cat. It's all the same to you. I was just trying out a new style of presenting, everyone. I was quite enjoying lying like this. As you can see, Tlalamba is extremely shocked by the lack of formality that I'm bringing to bear today. I was just thinking how amazing it would be, not that I encourage this or would think it was a good thing, but I do feel a sense of wanting to tickle her behind the ears, which I'm sure you all feel. And I was wondering how amazing it would be if she came wandering down here and sat next to the car. You know, we could just give her a little tickle behind the ears and say, don't worry, you know, you'll get your meal later. How's it going? But you don't want to do that with a wild cat, of course. Sometimes we get the impression that they are tame enough that they would do that, but they wouldn't. You would never get close enough to a wild leopard to touch it, I don't think. Ooh, Romit. Tamba, at the same age, you want to know how different her behavior is to his. I don't think we even had him anymore when he was 2. I think he'd already started moving away. Romit, so I don't know. He definitely wasn't as playful as she is. He seemed to mature very quickly. Although I think she's probably slightly unusually playful for a leopard of this age anyway. Well, I don't remember Tamba being anything like as playful. Tamba, for those of you who don't know, is Tandi's previous offspring, Tandi and Tingana, so full brother to Tlalamba, as far as we're aware. I don't remember him chuffing like this. I don't remember him interacting with Tingana much. Not like Hosana, who tended to actively seek Tingana out. I've not thought too much about that before. They must have met, I'm sure, and we probably viewed it a few times, but I don't remember. There was never the same desire to be around his father that Horsana showed. And then Tamba, of course, is territorial already. As a 3-year-old male leopard, territorial and mating. We always said he was a very serious fellow, so he's obviously taken his life goals very seriously. Young Tlalamba, not so serious. She's one of the most difficult leopards that I've ever had to follow, for example. When she gets on the move, she doesn't walk in one direction. She walks all over the place, up and down logs, never lies down for any length of time. That's when she's moving. She's obviously lying down for quite a long time today because there is a kill around. No, Donald, I've never seen Tingana playing like a kitten before. And I think male leopards are even less playful than male lions. I have seen male lions playing with their cubs, not for a long time, but they will do the odd kind of swat and play and, you know, gentle tap. But I have never seen a male leopard do that. I have heard, however, that Hukumuri has done it with Shadulu's cub, and that he has been known to actually be very affectionate, as far as male leopards can be. Tangana always seemed very reticent to be around his baby. And although she used to make contact with him quite frequently, she'd touch his backside or go up and smell him, he'd normally give her a bit of a growl to say, back off. And then, of course, in his inimitable fashion, he has begun stealing from her. Which, of course, he doesn't see. He doesn't see himself as stealing from her. He sees himself as getting a meal, right? Nice, Dave. Was that a little psychedelic movement there? She's awake a lot more than most leopards I know. Certainly much more than her father. Apparently Vorv is also awake, and so we go to go and find out how he feels about that.
Sorry, I was awake. Fell asleep on the move. I just got that link. Apparently I'm awake. Well, I nearly fooled you there, didn't I? Thought I was sleeping. We moved on from our bateleur family. We're going to continue now up Twin Dams Road and go and check a couple of the other little thoroughfares through the middle of Juma. See what we can find. And we'll pretty much cover the entire property this morning. We've gone almost everywhere except for the north. You never know. I mean, after rain like that, lions, leopards, they move. They move vast distances to reclaim and remark territory. So who knows? We might just be lucky. And no one's checked this road yet. And it's still nice and overcast. Still have things moving and hunting. Had many little groups of impala this morning. All of them looking pretty relaxed though. They must know the unkuhumas are off. Maddie, I haven't seen a pangolin here, but I know, I think in 2016 when we used to traverse Cheetah Plains, which is to the east on the Kruger boundary, I think Brent with someone got a pangolin there. Not to say we don't find them here, just I haven't seen one here. Dave was on camera with Brent. Very cool. Cool thing about a pangolin is if you find it, it's not really going anywhere. They don't move very fast. So you can actually get a lot of people or vehicles in to view. Okay, so the one that Brent and VM saw was running. They can move, but they don't normally move too fast. They normally feel quite sort of comfortable. They feel quite comfortable with their sort of protection. Okay, so vehicles come this way. Let's go check Ingwe Alley. The name is always inspires me to find a leopard on it. Ingwe Alley, Leopard Lane. A road that we find so many of our animals moving across. Take it. You see him? Just went across the road there. Very hard to frame them. There's so many dakers that are running around, but they are very shy, and they're always running. They stand very still, and as soon as you look at them, off they go. How many have we counted? Probably about 20 Dacre this morning. I'd love to know how many of them are the same. Pam, you want to know what is a pangolin? Pangolin is a sort of a South African armadillo. A very cool animal covered in shell, or should I say scutes, similar to a tortoise, but they move. They move. Very similar to an armadillo. They are ant termite eaters, and they can curl up into a ball to protect their vulnerable stomach, but the entire outer body is well protected against predation. But they are regarded as the number one trafficked animal in the world. They're regarded as a delicacy in many cultures, and their body armoring is actually valuable. I don't know what people use it for, but it fetches high price on the market, which is pretty sad. People catch them for eating. Highly, highly trafficked. So probably the most endangered animal on the African continent is the pangolin. Long face, very long tongue. That sticky tongue that shoots out into the holes in the ground to slurp up all the ants that they're looking for. So a little bit more adapted to feeding on the ants and termites than that starling. They were just pecking away. The pangolin have got sharp claws. They dig into the burrow and then blips, 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 blips. But before I go on any further, we're going to get to Ingwe Alley now. And let's send you back over to Tlalamba. On the move.
Live now. I promise, David. I promise you we're live. David's radio stopped working and he's trying to take pictures of the leopard. And he didn't hear that he didn't hear that we were live. Anyway, the daughter leopard cat has moved away. The daddy leopard cat hasn't moved. Then he thought I was joking. He probably still thinks I'm joking. I'm not. Is your radio not working? Are you getting that? She's saying comms test, comms test. He's back now. Right. I don't know if she's not going to go for a little drinky. Oh, here we go. Speed running. It's quite a slope she's standing on there, Dave. And there's a hyena in the background that we missed quietly. There you are. There's the meese. She spotted something that she thinks she might want to eat or play with. I don't know what it is. I can't see through the bushes here. In this particular area, I would suspect a duiker or an impala. Hear all the hornbills calling. In these situations, you want to move as little as possible. As we can see her, we'll just stay here. Hmm. stalking behavior. Let's just wait and see. She looks like she's about to strike. David, we might have a leopard kill. She'll almost certainly strike into the bushes, so we can't see what it is that she's striking at. I'm going to move now. Can't see what she's going for. She's gone behind that big tree. And now we're into that awkward space of not wanting to get too close and ruin it, but not wanting to be too far away and not having her at all. She's moving quite fast now. She's actually dead straight in front of us. Okay, I can see what she's going for. And they've seen her, I think. It's an impala, quite a long way away. I thought it had alarmed. No, it's just been the car. No, it hasn't seen her. Gonna have to move again, Dark. Can you see it there? It's a diker. We're so far at the end of the lens now. You still see her? I can just see her bottom right. Shall we move? I'm gonna have to move. Otherwise we're not gonna see anything. I don't think we're going to get through this area here. Oh, man. Don't worry about the noise. She's a long way from us. Sorry, I know this is very frustrating, everybody, but we really must be uber sensitive. Well, she's straight in front of us, Dave.
No, I don't see her anymore. I saw the diker run off.
You did see the... Oh, there she is. You did see the diker run off. I think she was spotted. I don't think it was us that caused that. Ruth, the largest animal a leopard hunt is normally about kudu-sized, kudu cow-sized. I've got a nasty feeling that I ruined that for her. It was very far in front of her there, so maybe I didn't. If I did, I'm sorry. My dear. Wow. That's a beautiful name. White Triangled Fatty. I want to know who the biggest leopard on Juma is. Tingana, I guess, would be the biggest leopard on Juma. Biggest female. Well, I mean, there are only two. This one and her mother. So her mother's probably slightly bigger than she is. Not much, though. The biggest female leopard I ever knew was one called the S-bend female. I suppose Sean Shadulu is probably bigger than Tandi and Tlalamba. So she's just not normally on Juma, but we do see her on Juma from time to time. So maybe Shadulu is the biggest. She's definitely bigger than they are. She's not bigger than average necessarily. I think they're slightly smaller than average and she may be slightly bigger. moving gently round here. David, any good? There she is. Nice and relaxed. Kalamba, I hope I didn't ruin that dike hunt for you. If I did, I do apologize profusely. You can hear the whoop whoop. Whoop whoop whoop. Active of late, those hoopoes. And then there's a crested barbet going. Not a very good impression, Talama, I'm sorry. Wow, this is going to be a special sighting, everybody. The Volve is going backwards.
I was reversing slightly. Feels like James is watching my every move. Yes, I was reversing for a moment. Sometimes you see something in the distance and you're not sure what it is. It's always important just to stop, reverse, have a look with your binoculars. You never know what it could be. If it just sort of sticks out for you, check it. Don't doubt. Don't ever feel bad when you're driving around and you tell your guide, oh, stop, I think I saw something. Because sometimes it is quite helpful. Another reason why we drive quite slowly. Looking at the ground, of course, for the tracks, which I haven't managed to find any of. No fresh lion or leopard. Lots of hyena tracks, of course, and unfortunately no wild dog. So where those dogs got to, it's hard to say. Now coming back up the middle of Juma, back towards where we started this morning with the kuru. We're going to just head on a little. What is that? There's a stump. Yes, it's a stump. Sometimes you get logs that look just like lions and leopards. And that one actually looked like the back of a hyena's head. It wasn't. It wasn't. The tracks of a female hyena at camp this morning, with a bit of a dragging leg. And it looked like possibly corky. Linus, you want to know why we don't see the pangolin on the dam cam? And they do need water. I'm sure they have to drink. Well, I'm not sure if they have to drink, but I'm pretty certain. Maybe they get enough moisture from the insects that they eat. I mean, there's lots of aardvarks around Druma as well, but have we seen one of them on the dam cam? I wonder. I mean, the benefit of being an insect eater is that you can get the moisture from the insect's bodies. It's one of the things that seed-eating birds, one of the sort of adaptations that they've evolved with their diet, is that seed-eating birds have to bring insects back to the nest for their chicks. It's only sand grouse and doves, pigeons, that are able to do something else. Sandgrass bring water back in the feathers of the male's chest to the nest, and the chicks drink the water off, and doves are able to produce pigeon milk, which is actually quite obviously quite moist and it's got lots of water, and that enables those doves and pigeons to have a form of liquid while they're in the nest. But seed eaters, the chicks, they are brought back caterpillars and grasshoppers, and then after they fledge, then they start feeding on seeds. So quite a mixture in the diet. So maybe aardvarks as well as pangolin get all their moisture from the insects. I'm going to assume that. Because we would definitely see them on the dam cam at some point. An aardvark coming down and slurping with his long nose. Maybe one of you out there who watches the dam cam regularly can tell us, have we seen aardvarks? So Karen, who watches the dam cam regularly, has never seen either on the dam cam. So it's an interesting one. They're both very secretive animals, so if they do drink, they probably get it from a water source that's not so exposed as that of the pan that's in an open area. That looked like an impala, but let's just double check. It's quite far down. Yes, an impala. Got to make sure. Tawny lions in this light are very similar color to impala. It's nice and overcast like this. There we go. A wildebeest male all the way over there. He's walking away from us. Should we go say hello? Fern, I'm glad that you're able to learn lots from us. It's objective, I suppose, is the educational aspect. I know it's also nice just to bumble around, but we try and get a lot of educational stuff going. Sometimes it's quite tricky when you can't find anything. More rhino lying down there, as well as a wildebeest. So we've been this way already this morning, but I just saw a wildebeest in the distance. Let's just go say hello to him. Go and ask him what's news. Okay, well, before we get to him, this is a very good example of what wildebeest males do. Yeah, we can see his tracks in the sand. Tracks in the sand there, as well as his dung. So wildebeest males will scratch. Here you can see where his feet have come in. There's his hooves, and they often scratch in a little midden. So here you can actually see where he's scratched over here. Wildebeest has got the toe that comes together in the front, but here, because he's splayed them out scratching, you can see how he's pushed a little back, and they'll often roll in this. And here is very, very fresh wildebeest poo. Very fresh. You can actually see how pliable it still is. Nice and soft inside, wet. Ooh, smells quite rank. Glad I've got that all over my fingers now. I'm not going to eat these ones, they're a bit too fresh. But wildebeest are very, very olfactory orientated. So he defecates, he'll turn the soil over, he'll probably roll in that as well. And then when he sees his ladies or he dominates a male, he'll then rub his neck area along the side, along the rump of the female to claim her as his own. They do often, well, they always roll in their own poop and urinate and scratch. See, so after a bit of rainfall, this guy has decided he's going to walk around his territory and reclaim it. Glands between their hooves, so pedal glands, as well as preorbital, just here below the eye. And the poo has got quite a smell to it as well, which obviously is his smell, and he likes to impart that on his ladies and on any male that he happens to dominate. I wonder if we're going to catch up with him or if he's going to go into the thickets. We might catch him. Just give us 1 second. See if we can catch this wildebeest. Obviously, if we can't, we'll just send you back over to James, who's having a very leopard fantastic kind of morning. Here he is on the left. There's a pull up and have a look at him. You got him, Owen?
Here we go. Let me just move back a touch. There we go, boy. He looks quite dry after the rain we had last night. Brindled gnu. Wonderful horns. Doesn't look very dirty, does he? Doesn't look very smelly. But I can assure you, he is quite smelly. Beautiful long tail, certainly the longest tail of their kind in the animal, in the sort of herbivore kingdom. I can't think of another. Horses have got very long tails, but the wildebeest really does have a wonderful tail. And of course, the only stump around, he's going to disappear behind. So he's looking, he's quite excited for the flush of green that's going to be coming through. Wildebeest are regarded as category 3 feeders, so in large numbers they actually do a lot of damage to the vegetation. Tweety Kid is looking amazing indeed. He's looking very, very good condition. And the zebra, as well as the rhino moving through these areas, will crop the grass quite nice and low, and that allows the vegetation to grow at the perfect height for the likes of wildebeest, who like it quite low and short. You notice in the Masai Mara, whenever we see the herds of wildebeest, they're always in the large, open, burnt areas where the grass is very short. Obviously, they are low feeders to the ground. They don't really feed on long grass. They can, but they prefer short grass. And also, that benefits them in their anti-predator avoidance strategy. Those lions can sneak up to them in the long grass, but when the grass is nice and short, they have a much harder time of doing that. And of course, the biomass generated by the beautiful soil of the Masai Mara creates these expansive fields of highly nutritious red oat grass, which attracts the largest accumulation of herbivores on the African continent. He's like, where? Where's this place? Yeah, such funny animals though, aren't they? Wildebeest. The blue wildebeest, also known as the brindled gnu by those stripes on the side of the body. Shoulders taller than the hindquarters. A similar sort of body posturing to that of hyena, as well as topi. It enables them to walk great distances, and when they run, it's a stamina type of posture. The back legs pushing them forward while the front legs elevate them a little bit. It gives them nice sort of movement over long distances, sort of marathon style in the animal kingdom. Peter, gnu is actually, I think, the European word. When you hear a wildebeest, they go gnu. I can't do it very well. It's quite a sort of amplified noise. And wildebeest was the name that the first Dutch settlers to the Cape called them, because they ran around like wild cows. And they look like cows. And wildebeest, when they get a bit excited, run around and they dance around and they look like wild cows. So wilde means wild and beest is cow. So wildebeest directly translated is wild cow. But they are also known as gnu, which is, I think, an English word derived from the noise that they make. Okay, well, we're going to move on. It seems like James is having a great morning. Klalamba is once again moving.
She is up. She's going back towards her daddy's kill, which is, strictly speaking, her kill, of course. And that seems to be where she's on her way to. Came up here to have a little bit of a break from waiting, from the inevitable boredom that must be when you're waiting for your daddy to finish his meal. Well, your meal. move along.
No, I don't think Kukumori and Mulwati are any threat at all to Tlalamba. Well, I say that. I mean, we know that Tingana ate two female leopards, so I'm not sure why they should be any different. And especially if she's in that sort of state where she's not quite yet at maturity. And so it'd be interesting to know if they saw her as an unrelated cub or as a female who is a potential mate. But I think she's probably out of the woods as far as being an unrelated cub is, so I don't think that she'd be a victim of infanticide at this stage of the game. I could be wrong. Behind that mob form, David. She's now lying down. Periwinkle Moon, what prevents the big cats from breeding with each other? Nothing. They do it fairly regularly. So inbreeding does happen. It's just not as dire as it is with human beings. Now she's feeling playful again. You see how she arches her back when she makes these little markings? That's not... I think that's entirely normal marking behavior. That's also true. James is making a good point there. She's been marking a lot since Luna arrived here. So Luna is another leopardess, similar sort of age, who came in from Biffle's Hook and has been knocking about here, mated with Tingana. And she's been marking a lot ever since then. Yep. Very true. Very true. Walking across the road here. And the hyena watching from the distance. And a leopard's tail is extremely appealing, even in photographs. If you just see a leopard's tail, as always, you can make quite a nice photo of just the tail. Same cannot be said for a hyena's tail, for example. Now this leopard is being naughty, because what she's trying to do here is she's just rather entertained by the hyena. And the hyena's saying, oh yeah, now what? What you gonna do, huh? It's fascinating. What happens here?
cool. Shelbel, you say that's a big hyena. It's not a huge hyena. It just looks big because of her. Hyenas get much bigger than that. And she's just very small. In comparison. Many of you are telling her to run away and go up a tree. You know, they're so fast. And I think even faster than we think they are. Because a hyena is not slow. Compared to the human being, a hyena is pretty quick. But a leopard just never seems to show any fear for a hyena's speed. I mean, for example, I mean, that leopard would never let you as a human being, unless she was extremely comfortable, get that close. She'd be much too threatened because she'd think, in her mind, she'd think, well, he'd probably be able to get me from there. And she goes running after the hyena again in the drainage line. We're down towards the drainage line, should I say. Not say much in it. What's your head there, David? Are we all right? Well, Chris, I think that that's actually not a bad thought. I think she is looking for a playmate. Sorry, struggling to find a route through here. Oh, dear. Hold on, David. Tingana has not moved one inch. Okay, they're going to meet up over here, in the middle, I think. The leopard is stalking the hyena. The leopard was stalking the hyena. But is no longer. Here we go. And the hyena's not vaguely afraid of the leopard. As much as the leopard isn't afraid of the hyena. Figo just coming up to see if something's perhaps been dropped in the interim. It hasn't. Tingana still up in the branches, almost invisible. I'm going to sit here. I find it difficult not to take this slightly for granted, but we're sitting here with two leopards. Which is very special. Louise says it's the best birthday present ever. Louise, there are a couple of guitars I could have received for my birthday that would make it would slightly better. But certainly it's right up there. Keeping an eye on Chalumba, who's got up and is now looking sort of back the way. I don't know why. Chuffing again at Dad. No, Donna, I don't know how old he is, but he's not a youngster. I mean, he's fully grown. The hyena now. I think she's going to launch in a little attack and then run away quickly. Hyena's realized that she's there. Or maybe Tlalamba thinks there's something on the ground that's been dropped that the hyena's now eating. Oh, she's right at the base. Can you still see her, Dave?
Yep.
Hyena's given up. Tlalamba snuck to the bottom of the tree, I think almost unnoticed by Tingana. I almost don't want to move for the same reason that I don't want to move at a potential kill, because I can't hear him growling, which makes me think he hasn't noticed her. No, Stephen, Tlalamba and Tingana see each other at this particular stage in much the same light as they see the hyena as a competition for food. They don't see each other as teammates against a scavenger. It's really very, very unlikely that she'll go up the tree. I think she thought the hyena had spotted something underneath there. And Lord Muck up there isn't vaguely fazed by anything he's seen this morning. That's quite cool. Her little eyes. Are we closing on me?
No, just a goodbye.
Oh, bye-bye. Bye. We have 30 seconds left, everyone. So David thought he'd come back to me. That's policy, you see. Should be at 90 seconds, of course. But at 90 seconds, the cat was doing something interesting. All right, we'll see you later this afternoon, everyone. Thank you for your kind questions and comments and for your very kind birthday wishes. See you later.